Namaste and good evening. My name is Mihir Magani, and I'm a co-founder and board member of the Hindu American Foundation. I live in Fremont, California. HAF, the Hindu American Foundation, is an educational and advocacy organization established in 2003. HAF focuses on educating the public about Hindus and Hinduism and advocating for policies and practices that ensure the well-being of all people and the planet. We are a nonpartisan, nonprofit, tax-exempt public charity pursuant to Internal Revenue Code Section 501c3. On behalf of the foundation's entire board of directors, staff, I'd like to welcome all of you to day one of our first ever virtual advocacy forum entitled Dharma Advocacy, Empowering Hindus at Home and Abroad. We have a great program and lineup of speakers planned over the course of the next 2 days. Today, we'll focus on foreign policy issues and issues of human rights. Tomorrow, we'll shift over to domestic policy and advocacy at the local and state level, taking on issues from textbooks to the swastika to empowering young Hindu Americans on college campuses. We'll also be meeting with a number of congressional representatives representing both major political parties over the next few days to advocate for the policy issues that you believe in and that HAF is fighting for. Please do engage with us during the next 2 days on social media. And please write down this hashtag, which we'll be putting into the chat throughout the evening, hashtag HAFADFO2020. That's pound or hashtag HAFADFO for Advocacy Forum 2020. HAFADFO2020. Please use that in all your social media so that we create buzz about this great first of its kind event. If you're interested in learning more about advocacy, we have a special Dharma Advocates training coming up on October 1st. Many of you who are Dharma ambassadors are familiar with this sort of training. And you can be one of the inaugural Dharma advocates by registering by October 1st on our website at hinduamerican.org, going to the events tab on the top right and clicking on upcoming events. Space is limited, so sign up today. Let's get this program, exciting program started. And we're going to kick off tonight's program with a beautiful invocation by Hindu American renowned vocal artist and attorney Vindhya Adappa. Vindhya is a 2014 graduate at the University of Pennsylvania Law School. She currently serves as the Associate General Counsel of Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society, HIAS. That is an international refugee settlement agency and the world's oldest refugee settlement agency. She has also worked in the private sector at the United Nations and even served in Africa. She recently made her singing debut with a Bollywood release by Z Music of the song Chal Mere Bhaiya, a peppy song composed by Anuj Garg. Vindhya says she's driven by a desire to use her voice with intention, inspiration, and change. You can follow her on Instagram at Vindhi Music. Let's hear the invocation.
Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kuru Me Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada Om Bhur Bhuva Svaha Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi. Diyo Yo Na Prachodaya. Shanti, Shanti.
Thank you, Vindhya, for that beautiful invocation. I just wanted to add a few words to explain the significance of the invocation dedicated to Lord Ganesh for the mantra. For tonight, we have a wide range of people here, not just Hindus, but people representing the public sphere, elected officials, and representatives. Ganesh, the manifestation of the divine who removes obstacles, is invoked at the beginning of any endeavor for his blessings. The shloka you just heard to Ganesh means, O Lord Ganesh, with the curved trunk, large body, and the brilliance of millions of a million suns, may my efforts be free of obstacles always. The second mantra was the Gayatri mantra. By chanting this powerful mantra, we pay for spiritual unfoldment. It means, may the light of consciousness come to shine forth its radiance through my intellect. Thus may perception of the world be clear. May discernment be subtle. My judgments be correct and quick, may comprehension of situations be precise and wise. We had originally planned on having the Indian ambassador to the United States, Honorable Ambassador Taranjit Singh Sandhu, with us this evening. But due to an emergency scheduling conflict, Ambassador Sandhu is no longer available to address our advocacy forum. We look forward to having him speak at one of our events in the near future. We still have a wonderful program of human rights, and we're going to start with a short documentary video on the plight of Pakistani Hindu refugees in Jodhpur, in India's western state of Rajasthan.
I think we're having a little bit of technical difficulty with Mihir's side. So as Mihir was saying, we're going to start with a refugee video. And I think we have you back, Mihir. So if you want to go ahead and continue.
Okay, we're going to. This refugee video was made during a fact-finding trip to Jodhpur by a team of human rights activists and physicians sponsored by the Hindu American Foundation. Their plight, along with those Hindus and other minorities that fled persecution in Afghanistan and Bangladesh, was the catalyst of India passing its famous refugee bill called the Citizenship Amendment Act. It was designed to help provide these religious refugees that you're going to see in this video with an expedited path to citizenship in India, and by extension, humane living conditions and economic opportunities within India. We will now play the video, Victims of History, the Untold Story of Pakistani Hindu Refugees in India, and you'll be able to watch this on Hindu American Foundation's YouTube channel again.
वैसे उधर तो हिंदू की तो जगह भी नहीं है, मुसलमानों की जगह में रहना पड़ता है। मजदूरी करने गए या खेती बाड़ी करने गए तो उनका मन चाहा तो कुछ 10 रुपए दे दिए, नहीं चाहा तो नहीं। इसलिए मेरी साली थी, उनको उठा के ले गए, तो अभी तक भी उसका पता भी नहीं है। हम तो परिवार लेके वीजा पासपोर्ट लेके आराम से जाएंगे।
चार प्लस चार, चार गुना चार। मौका मिला तो बनूंगी। देखो कितने बड़े बड़े डॉक्टर हैं यहाँ पर।
Over 100,000 of them are scattered throughout India. Almost 1,000 cross the border into India state of Rajasthan each year. They are mothers and fathers, grandparents, sisters and brothers, aunts and uncles. They are stateless. These are the faces of the refugees who have fled Pakistan, their country of birth. They are no longer welcome there because they are Hindu.
जहाँ हिंदुस्तान का कानून है वैसे पाकिस्तान का कानून नहीं है.
अच्छा.
और वहाँ का कानून बहुत कमज़ोर है.
अच्छा.
क्योंकि जो जिनके पास पैसा होता है उसकी सुनवाई होती है.
हाँ.
और जिनके पास पैसा नहीं तो उनकी सुनवाई नहीं होती है.
अच्छा.
और वहाँ ज़्यादा चोरी चकारी बहुत ज़्यादा होती है.
अच्छा.
अगर किसी के घर में सोना चांदी होता है तो वो भी लूट के चले जाते हैं.
हाँ.
या किसी का पहना होता है वो भी उठा के ले जाते हैं.
अच्छा.
और वहाँ तो खुलेआम बंदूकें हथियार वगैरह सब ऐसे खुलेआम चलते हैं.
They fled from daily persecution, social prejudice, and economic exploitation. They fled to save their daughters from being kidnapped, forcibly converted to Islam, and married off to unknown Muslim men. They fled so they could openly and freely practice their religion.
पहले बच्ची एक छोटी बच्ची थी हमारी, छह महीने की थी वो बच्ची जो है वो उसको भी बारम दे दिया था कि ये लड़की ने इस्लाम कबूल कर लिया. मैं ये कैसे इस्लाम कबूल कर सकती है, इसकी तो उम्र नहीं है, ये कुछ भी नहीं जानती है, अपनी माँ को भी नहीं समझती कि कौन है कौन नहीं है.
Leaving most of their possessions behind, they came to India in search of a new life. In spite of meeting the criteria under international law, these migrants are still not officially recognized as refugees, and thus they are struggling to survive without the protections that refugee status brings. Already having endured immense suffering in Pakistan, the refugees today live in makeshift camps and in extreme poverty without basic shelter, adequate food, or clean drinking water.
नागरिकता की सबसे ज़्यादा तकलीफ है क्योंकि नागरिकता की वजह से ना तो यहाँ लाइट ले सकते हैं, ना पानी ले सकते हैं, ना काम मिल सकता है. और तो और पानी और लाइट तो बहुत ज़रूरी है. यहाँ के गर्मियों में इतने मच्छर होते हैं, एक दिन में बड़े से बड़े आदमी को मलेरिया हो जाता है. तो बच्चे भी हैं छोटे छोटे, तो उनका क्या हाल होता होगा. वो चैन से नींद भी नहीं ले सकते. आज के ही जाके दूसरे के किसी के मकान में भी रहें तो बिना नागरिकता के मकान किराए पर नहीं दे रहा है. जहाँ फैसिलिटी है, पानी है वगैरह, वो तो किराए पे नहीं दे रहा है. तो आप मान के चलो कि यहाँ जंगलों में रहना पड़ रहा है.
Hundreds of these camps exist in India. Over 400 such camps have been erected in western Rajasthan alone.
फिर भारत में आए, भारत में आए तो हम दो साल जेल में रह के आए. हम खाजवाड़े चले गए, अपने कोई भांजे के ब्याह था. बस के तुम्हारे को तो जोधपुर में रहना है और इधर कहाँ से. हमारे पिताजी अर्जुन राम वो भी हमारे साथ थे.
In January 2013, a team of doctors from the Hindu American Foundation visited three such camps, housing some 1,300 Hindu refugees in Jodhpur. The property that this camp sits on belongs to a private real estate developer who has allowed the refugees to remain there. But even this is temporary. Soon, construction on a hotel will begin, and the refugees will have to leave. But where will they go? Returning to Pakistan is not an option. When asked about the possibility of being sent back to Pakistan, most either break down in tears or say they would rather die than go back. But neither India nor the international community has yet to find a viable and permanent solution to this growing crisis. This large-scale migration of Hindus from Pakistan is only likely to increase as conditions for minorities continue to deteriorate there. Beyond a humanitarian disaster, it may have far-reaching consequences for stability in the subcontinent. How long will their plight be tolerated? How long before the international community comes to their aid? How long can we stay silent?
This video, of course, is several years old, and the stories that HAF leaders, Arvind Chandrakant and Samir Kalra, brought back are really heart-wrenching. This HAF staff member who led this trip to these refugee camps and who's continued to work with refugees on the ground is one of our managing directors, Samir Kalra, and he's going to be moderating our panel on human rights. The conditions of these Pakistani Hindu refugees are now beginning to improve with the passage of India's famous Refugee Act, known as the Citizenship Amendment Act. Samir Kalra is a managing director at the Hindu American Foundation, and he's based in Fremont, California as well. He holds a Juris degree from Santa Clara University School of Law, and he leads the foundation's human rights advocacy efforts. And he served as a panelist at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., and multiple congressional briefings on human rights and religious freedom in South Asia. In January 2013, Mr. Kalra conducted a one-week human rights fact-finding mission to the refugee camps in Jodhpur that we just talked about. And from that, he wrote a foreword for a book called about Bangladesh entitled A Quiet Case of Ethnic Cleansing, The Murder of Bangladeshi's Hindus. I'm proud to introduce Samir Kalra, our moderator for this evening.
Great. Thank you very much, Mihir, for the kind introduction. And namaste and good evening to everyone. And we're so glad that you could join us today for a very informative, hopefully an exciting panel. And we're thrilled to have two human rights experts and activists who are really lifelong activists on human rights issues in South Asia with us today to discuss specifically Hindu human rights around the world, under siege, under threat, under lockdown. Now, while Hindu minorities have faced state-sponsored discrimination, violence, and persecution in countries ranging from Afghanistan to Malaysia to Guyana and beyond, our panel today will specifically be focusing on the historical and modern-day persecution of Hindus in Pakistan and Bangladesh, two countries where Hindus face acute challenges and where conditions continue to rapidly deteriorate, leading them to continue to flee for safety and refuge in India. To discuss these two countries in more detail, we're honored to be joined today by Mr. Ashok Karmaker and Dr. Rubina Greenwood. Ashok Karmaker is a chairman of the Board of Governors of the Bangladesh Hindu Buddhist Christian Unity Council. Based in New York City, Mr. Karmaker is an attorney with a private practice largely focused on asylum and other immigration issues. Prior to coming to the United States, Mr. Karmaker worked as a judge for nearly 5 years as a member of the judiciary of Bangladesh, and later served 3 years as a counsel officer of the Honorable Minister of Law, Justice, and Parliamentary Affairs of Bangladesh. Mr. Karmaker holds a master's in human rights from the Institute of Commonwealth Studies, University of London, and an LLM from the Columbia University Law School, and is a member of the New York State Bar. We're also joined by Dr. Rubina Greenwood, who is a chairwoman, of the World Sindhi Congress, which has branches in the UK, US, and Canada. And she's a founder of International Sindhi Women's Organization, UK. She's also a founding member of Sindhi Baloch Forum, UK. As a human rights campaigner, Dr. Greenwood has been raising awareness about the human rights situation in Sindh at international platforms since the late 1990s. She is a regular presenter at the United Nations Human Rights Council and the European Parliament. Her work mainly focuses on the marginalization of indigenous Sindhis, including lesser minorities of Sindh and their civil, political, and development rights within Pakistan. Dr. Greenwood was born in Shikarpur, Sindh, and she earned a PhD from the University of Glasgow, Scotland in the UK. Dr. Greenwood is currently working as a head of digital railway systems at Network Rail UK. We're going to go ahead and start our panel now with opening remarks by both Mr. Karmaker and Dr. Greenwood for 10 minutes, and then I'll facilitate a moderated discussion with both of them. And we'll conclude the evening's panel with a question and answer session with the audience. I want to invite you to please use a Q&A function at the bottom of your screen to submit any questions anytime throughout the program. And my colleague and HAF Director of Public Policy, Taniel Koshakjin, will be selecting questions from there, and we'll try our best to get to as many questions as possible. With that, I want to go ahead and pass it on to Mr. Karmaker, to go ahead and start the program.
Thank you. Namaskar and good evening and good morning for people who are in Bangladesh or India who are watching us. And thank you first, Hindu American Foundation, for arranging this seminar, this web seminar, and giving me the opportunity to bring up the matters, the plights of Bangladeshi Hindus, what has been going on for years and years and for decades. And I would like to thank the Indian government too, because of India, I am here now. We've been offered refuge, shelter in India in 1971 in a refugee camp. So my gratitude to India and its great people, and also to the US, obviously, for giving me the refuge, permanent refuge, and giving me the opportunity to thrive as a human being with dignity. And for Bangladeshi people who are fighting, Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist, and Christians who are fighting this, our cause, I am thankful to them too. First of all, I would like to focus on the terms, that the coinage of terms Hindu human rights. So you always see that human rights, but this is the first time I think Hindu American Foundation who coined the words Hindu human rights. Why Hindu human rights? How it is different from human rights? I'd like to focus on it a little bit. Before going to answer this question, I'd like to say that we always hear women's rights are human rights. If you go back to 1995, when then First Lady Hillary Clinton first coined these words, women's rights are human rights. Because women's rights also should be included in human rights, because human rights is for all, it is universal. But there are sometimes, some points of time when people, a group of people, they think their rights are not that much important, that given importance to their rights, and it has some particularity. So that is the same reason why Hindus feel that way. Because if you look at the history, Hindus are being victims of plight, victims of atrocities in India, even in Bangladesh. We have been, that has been going through on Hindus for decades. And we are declining in numbers every year, every single day. But international media or national media did not give that much attention to that cause. Look at the Kashmiri Pandits. They have been made refugees in their own land, in their own country. But how much we know about them? So I think this is the time to focus on these terms. But at the same time, I would like to caution our people to think that we are not against any other group, any other religious belief or anything. So when we call women's rights, are not necessarily against men, or children's rights are not necessarily against their parents. So Hindu human rights has a really significant thing at this point, when we know that because Hindus are only majority in India, and even in India, there are about 12 states where Hindus are minority. So other than India and Nepal, you can see in most other countries, Hindus are minority. But our cause is not given that much importance. So that's why it is very logical and relevant at this point of time to coin this word Hindu human rights. Thank you, HAF. Now, I would like to come back to Bangladesh, because Bangladesh is a real example where Hindus are minorities, but it has significant portion of minority. If you go back to 1951, we can see the slide here. You will see in 1951, there were about 22% Hindus in Bangladesh, according to Bangladesh Census Bureau. And it gets on declining, and coming to 2011, our number went down to 8.5%, according to Bangladesh Census Bureau. And obviously, we have another source. You see a quiet case of ethnic cleansing written by Dr. Richard Benken and forwarded by Attorney Samir Kalra. That shows that in 1947, the Hindus were about 33%. And now today, it became less than 8%. So this is declining. The number is declining every single day. And if you see the another slide, that will show that is how many people are living every single day. Not this, another one, number three. Yes, this one. So if you look at this, and also you can see that how Hindu people are getting diminished every single day. Every single day, according to this census or statistics, 770 people leaving Bangladesh every single day. And obviously, Professor Abul Barkat, one of professor, very renowned professor, in Dhaka University. He mentioned, or he kind of, he said that, or professed that in 30 years, there will be no Hindus left in Bangladesh. Hope not. So my point is, these people are declining every single day, but where they are going? The next question will be, where they are going? These people, every single day, 770 people leaving Bangladesh, they are going somewhere. Where they are going? The next question will be that, if you look at this chart by Pew Research, then you will see the next one. You can see, according to Pew Research Center, based in the USA, it says Bangladesh is the second largest nation in the world who about migrating Hindus. The Hindu people who are migrating from any country to other countries, Bangladesh is the second one. How many? It is 2.76 million. And India is the first. Obviously, they have the most Hindu people in the world. And that is only 5.33 million. And India is the one who is taking these Hindu people. How many? There is more than 3.66 million. They're taking. So if you put this, juxtapose these two sides, that means people who are leaving Bangladesh, the Hindu people who are leaving Bangladesh and migrating to other countries, and India is the one who is taking them. Now, the question is, how it is happening? That means, why these people, why these Hindus are leaving their own country to some other country, particularly for India? So we have tried to understand this, and obviously we can say they have all the regions. There are regions like, you can see the political regions, obviously. There are political regions, political lack of political goodwill. Bangladesh government, Bangladesh was established under the promise that it will be a secular country, and in 1971, but if you can see after 71, it was declared it will be a secular democracy, but only for a few years. And then it was turned into a Islamic state, calling the state religion as Islam. And no other government really tried to solve this problem, even not this one. So political lack is always there. Lack of political goodwill, good intention, are the first thing we can say. And you can see in 2001 to 2006, during the Four Party Alliance, when they were in power, there are lots of atrocities went on on Hindus. And you know, at that time, there are one investigation commission was formed by people like, we call it People's Inquiry Commission. And it was headed by Professor Jillu Rahman, one of the renowned professors in the country. And they could not even publish the report until 2012. And in 2009, when the present government came to power, they formed another commission called Shahabuddin Commission, one of the district judges, Muhammad Shahabuddin, who headed that commission. And this commission actually took cognizance of 362 incidents. And they discussed everything, and they published, they actually made a report. And very unfortunate though, this report was never published. This was never published, and let alone act on it. So that's why I can say the lack of political goodwill, good faith efforts by the government, all the successive governments, is a first reason for the Hindus to leave Bangladesh. And obviously there are legal reasons. There are economic reasons that most of the Hindu businesses cannot sustain anymore because of the social pressure, political pressure, and geopolitical region that you can see. Obviously, you know that Sino-Pak alliance, they're trying to undermine the system in Bangladesh so that they can have more power, they have more control over the situation than in Bangladesh. obviously there are other social harassments, lack of good intention of the administration, obviously, you can see. All these regions, we can find out that the region for the Hindus leaving Bangladesh. Then there are other, these operations going on and going on, we can see how they do it. There are many ways that are doing it. First of all, grabbing land, that is one thing, forced conversion, and also you can see there are a lot of rape, killing, arson, using draconian laws. Right now we have the Digital Act, and they are using Digital Act obviously against everybody, but minorities are being more victims of it because of double jeopardy in their case. And nowadays you can see Facebook, the social media, became a very much curse for the minorities. In recent years, I should say about last 8-9 years, starting in 2012, they started that in Rabu, when the Buddhist people being killed and slaughtered using fake user ID in a Facebook, saying that they said something against Islam, when ultimately it was proved that this Buddhist person, he was not the person who opened this Facebook account. So it happened like not one or two. And even the latest we can see in the Bhola, in one district in Bangladesh, they're using the same way. So all the fake accounts are being opened, and then they are blaming Hindus for making all these comments on Islam. But all the fake things and the administration, you will see hardly work on it. Actually, what they do, ultimately, they take that person that who is innocent into custody. And they then try to make him to confess that he did something. So this is another way. And rumors and then grabbing cemetery. Nowadays, you see Hindu cemeteries are being grabbed. They are being evacuated, evicted from that. That means you cannot live as a Hindu, and you cannot even die as a Hindu. So this is also happening there. And obviously enforced disappearance. That is happening in Bangladesh a lot. Obviously, Hindus are not the only ones that who are the victims of it. The majority of them are Muslims. So, but I'm telling you, this is another kind of human rights violation. And obviously, Hindus as part of the minority or a part of the whole population, they are also victim of it. And this is all happening and you can see this is another slide. If you can see that slide, it will show the widespread nature of this. This one. It will show that only in last 3 months, June, July, and August, how many incidents happened against Hindus. So, and also you will see in all the places of Bangladesh, except one place that you cannot see any dot, that is Sundarbans, because nobody lives there, right? So everywhere it is widespread. It is not that government will always try to show and say that is very sporadic. It has no connection with one incident to another. But it will show only in last 3 months when this pandemic hit Bangladesh, and still it is under pandemic, and what happens. So still these attacks are going on and under the very nose of the administration, and hardly they do anything. So these are the reasons why the Hindus will be leaving. And then what do they go? They go to India, we already see that. And now when India enacted the CAA or Citizenship Amendment Act. I see many people, even human rights organizations, they were against this. Our question is, how can this law, that is a long overdue law, and it's a human rights law, piece of legislation, that was done to give these people some kind of legality, because these people, millions of people, who has been living in Bangladesh and left Bangladesh means they were forced to leave Bangladesh and they now went to India, and they are living under shadow, and they have no legality, and they are living there in that way. So it's like in permanent blackmailing situation. And what happens, this government, the present government in India, I salute them and I really endorse their great act that they are coming forward to offer kind of legality, legal documents so that they can live there as a human being. This is a great piece of human rights legislation. And you know what, in this world, this is not the first. In the USA, we have, there are lots of similar laws. And if we can see, these laws are there already. Lautenberg Law, Lautenberg Amendment to the Foreign Operations Appropriations Act, that is exactly kind of same law that was enacted by the US government to help the Jewish people coming from the former Soviet Union and from Iran. So this is good. This has been hailed as a good act because they came forward to help people who are under threat. So if that is true, then why not this one? This CIA is also human rights law, the piece of legislation. But you know what? I see sometimes that the anti-CIA lobby, they're trying to say that this is not a human rights one. And I should say another, this is not only Lautenberg Law, there are other laws in the USA that also give some kind of reprieve, some rights to people from different countries. I can tell you that, but you know, most like I can say, you know, those are the laws, I should say, Cuban Adjustment Act, Indo-Chinese Parolee Adjustment Act, Americian Homecoming Act, Polish-Hungarian Parolee Act, Nicaraguan or Nicara law. So all these laws are there to benefit some people from different geographic area or people who have different religious faith. So CA is one of them, and we should hail them that, you know, this present government has the political courage and integrity to come up with this kind of law. But the anti-CA lobby, what they try to say, before reading the lines of the law, they try to read between the lines. That is kind of ridiculous, because what they're trying to say that a certain group will be disadvantaged by this law. Our point is, did you ever hear a human rights movement that wants that people who are in danger, that they should be stripped of their rights? So these people, they are asking for scrapping this law that is giving shelter, that is giving some recognition to people, millions of people who have been living under shadow. So if they really want something else, if they say, okay, you know what, there are some other people, other group, they should be offered that kind of legal relief or remedy, they should come forward and try to show the rationale behind it, that why and how these people should be granted that. And at the same time, other people, they have their own rationale that can be discussed. But these people are now asking for scrapping this law, that is very much negative. So my point will be that we can just ask this organization that who are against this CA to ask for their rationale behind it and actually what we can do. I'd like to mention a few things here, that what we can do in the US, because we can see that these people that who left Bangladesh and now living in India under shadow, they do not have any voice. They have no representative. So they only us, the Hindu American Foundation, and our organization, Bangladesh Hindu Buddhist Christian Unity Council USA, we are trying to lobby for them that, you know, these people should have a voice and they should be granted that legal status. And now in the USA, what I think we can do we can hold seminars like these ones with other people like who are against CAA. We can also ask and engage with like-minded organizations and also people who are really against us, but to discuss that why they are thinking that way. I engage with different human rights organizations. And also, I think we have already been told that HAF is trying to take initiative to engage the youngsters, younger generation. That will be very nice because we need that. And also, I should say that I see many times we are very defensive, but we have to be very offensive that way, that we have to ask them that come up with your rationale. This law is such a good law. How come you really go against this? So we can do that. At the same time, what India can do at this point? I think India needs to be more proactive than reactive, because India has a real geopolitical interest in Bangladesh. And as a democratic country, India, it has lots of at stake, being its neighbors, being not democratic, and there are lots of turmoil. So India has a democratic and human rights interest in Bangladesh too. And historical point of view, you can see India is the one who helped Bangladesh to gain its independence. India has own security interest here too. I think they understand that better than me. And how we can involve USA. USA has a real interest in Bangladesh. Now, Sino-Pak alliance, they are trying to make Bangladesh is a theocratic country so that it will be able to pressure India. And at this point, I think it is USA should come forward in our help. It will help them too, because it is our democratic interest. And USA can many more things USA can do, in Bangladesh. The Bangladesh government should be made realize that what they have been doing is not right. So the agencies, the organizations that are involved in persecution, they should not be allowed to come out and serve in the UN bodies. So United States can make a big role in doing that. And also people who are accused of human rights violation, they can be enlisted. And any organization that is also involved in human rights violation in Bangladesh against minorities and against any other person or individual, they can be made under entity list. I think that should be good. And also, I think we have some proposal for Indian government regarding CAA. I think I'm not sure whether any rules or regulations have been made under the CAA. If not, that should be done very quickly. And what we need there, because of my experience and my information that what I am giving, what we are really getting from West Bengal, India, they are being harassed now, people who they think might come out and they might get benefit out of due to this CAA. They started harassing them, and many of them are getting arrested. That is kind of court message so that nobody comes out and try to take benefit of this CAA. So the Indian government should make rules decriminalizing any act. Any act means when people went to India, they might have made papers, obviously with not correct information. So people, when they leave their countries out of fear and out of fear of their lives, many times they do that, and they have to do that for their own survival. And obviously in our, in general penal code, we'll always criminalize those acts, like having new names, incorrect information about the parents, dates of birth, places of birth. So this should be decriminalized right away so that people can ensure that they will be not be penalized. They will not be penalized for the acts they have done out of fear of their own lives. It has to be done very quickly, and people should be given some idea. They ensured that, you know, if they come out, they are not going to be punished, that they are not going to be sent back to Bangladesh. And last of all, our proposal to government of Bangladesh, because Bangladesh is our land of birth. We still feel like that it is not too late. Bangladesh is still not Pakistan. It has some future. So we want to work with Bangladesh government to see how it can be much better for minorities. When they can do something good for minorities, that will help them too in general. We are part of the community and we want to work with them. And meaningfully, they should meaningfully engage the minorities. And to that end, the government of Bangladesh can obviously establish a ministry that will be manned by mostly minorities people without any pressure from the government side. So I think in the future, it can solve. And obviously, CAA is giving them great opportunity to understand that what happened. And it is everything was being sent under the rug before. As if nothing happened, every time the government of Bangladesh, they would be trying to say nobody left Bangladesh. Everybody who left Bangladesh because they wanted to have a better life. But with the CAA, we'll understand that Bangladesh, the Hindus who left Bangladesh, they were forced. And the government of Bangladesh must show their integrity and their good intention. You know that in Bangladesh, still there is a law called vested property law. It was previously called enemy property law. And the government recently made another law that says vested property return act. That means people who lost their property, apparently shows people who lost their properties will be able to get it back. But it is not true because the way it is made, so people who already left Bangladesh because of this law and went to India, they will not be able to claim any property under this law. The law already says that, it's section 6 already says, if you who left the country will not be able to claim under that law. That means what? They've been forced and now they are being made out of that. So we want the government of Bangladesh to act honestly and with good faith so that we can solve the problem. And I think with this, I will stop here and we'll be taking questions if you have. And thank you very, very much.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Karmaker. And before we pass it on to Dr. Greenwood, I do want to just emphasize a couple of things that you said very briefly that I think are very important for our attendees to remember is, one, by demanding our rights as Hindus and as persecuted religious minorities, that does not mean that we are against anybody else, any other religion, any country. All we are doing is just asking for equal rights for those particular groups of minorities, whether they are in Pakistan, whether they're in Bangladesh, whether they are in India or anywhere else around the world. So as Hindus, we have to remember that we should not be hesitant or scared to stand up for our rights and for the rights of Hindu persecuted Hindus anywhere in the world. The second thing I think was very important that you noted, Mr. Karmaker, is that people that are opposed to the Citizenship Amendment Act haven't even read the act. And so I think it's important to understand, first of all, that this was a humanitarian and human rights law that was very specifically dealing with the very acute problem, a humanitarian crisis that was brewing within India because of all of these hundreds of thousands of refugees that were living on the margins of society, and to give them new hope. And through that, and through legal citizenship, an expedited path to citizenship, to give them more economic opportunities and the ability to have a new life within India. And so it's very important to understand that this was not done to strip anybody's rights. And the language of the bill, nowhere does it say in the actual bill that anybody is losing their rights within India as Indian citizens. This is just specifically dealing with religious minorities that have fled the countries of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, And Mr. Karmaker pointed out a number of similar parallel bills that we have here in the US. And there are many across the world that are dealing with very specific acute problems. And that's where the CAA has come in. So I think it's our duty to educate people on that, to engage with people that are opposed to it. And as Mr. Karmaker pointed out, engage them in a conversation and dialogue and ask them to really point out what is wrong with this law without getting into propaganda or hyperbole. So thank you for emphasizing that, Mr. Karmaker. And I think we're going to get into a few follow-up questions during our discussion, but I do want to now pass it on to Dr. Greenwood to shift the conversation a little bit over to Pakistan for the next 10 minutes. Dr. Greenwood?
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Perfectly, thank you.
Right, okay. First of all, I would like to thank Hindu American Foundation for giving me an opportunity to speak today. Because not that often voices of lesser known minorities of Pakistan get opportunity to raise their voice on international forums, really. This is very very usual to the European, at least where I'm based in the UK, but in European forums, generally issues related with Hindus, marginalization in Pakistan is very less known or maybe not known. So I would really welcome this sort of opportunity. And other thing is that I'm surrounded by today's a lot of many lawyers here and qualified people. I'm just an activist, and I'll be looking up to you guys to really help me and guide us what we need to do as an activist. So just bear in that mind, and then we will look at that. So last year, when the U.S. State Department released its list of countries of the particular concern that have engaged in or tolerated severe violations of religious freedom, Pakistan was added to the special watch list. And this brought some sigh to relief to, as an activist, to myself, and a human rights advocacy groups such as World Sindhi Congress, who have continually engaged in creating awareness against the atrocity inflicted to non-Muslims and in particularly Sindhi Hindus in Pakistan. The hope was that such designations and such sort of a international cry would encourage Pakistan to step up and rectify the systematic and way of practice religious persecution of its religious minorities. But I'm afraid it didn't happen. Pakistan is world's fifth largest populated country and is home to more than 200 million people. Although predominantly it's a Muslim country, but 4% of population is non-Muslims. And surprisingly, the Hindus form is the largest non-minority and minority, religious minority group forms. And if you look at the international campaign about the religious minority, Hindu doesn't appear as much as you could see other religions. Not that I always talk about all, minorities, but I just wanted to bring that point that even UK's Foreign Office report published a report, it was hardly mentioned about the Hindus in those international reports. So this is where I will be looking into. Pakistan is known as one of the world's most religious intolerant countries. We all know freedom of religion is loosely legislated. Religious minorities regularly suffer violence and discrimination. The intolerance is such as that 75% of Hindus have been forced or coerced into leaving their motherland in search of safety. And as you've seen in the video, but this is more systematic. It's been going on last seven decades of existence. So if you look at in 1947, when this so-called Pakistan was formed, we had about 27% of population of Sindh was Hindu Sindhis. Now it's reduced to 7% of the population. It's huge loss to as a being a Sindhi to our community, to our nation, our cream has lost. And to be honest, when you just showed this video, it was a really sad feeling rise in my emotionally feeling that how our own brothers and sisters are being displaced when we have a you know, they have their own motherland. They shouldn't be there. They shouldn't be in that situation, what we've seen on the video. Sindh, many people probably not know, is its southeastern province, is home to the majority of Hindus in Pakistan. Though a historical Kali, it's Sufi and tolerant place. Under the rule of Pakistan, it has become a difficult place for Hindus. Hindus are systematically face official and social discriminations, including kidnapping, forced conversion, extortion, discrimination in public as well as in the private sectors. They are not entirely free to exercise their religious freedom. And in recent years, attacks in their places of worship have increased substantially. And a lot of international media, such as New York Times, have covered the incidents in the Shikarpur and Larkana, where the temples were destroyed. Hindu traders and middle-class men face violence and are subjected to kidnapping for ransom. Hindu businesses owners regularly face extortion with open negligence of the police. Local daily newspapers are full of such report incidents in Sindh and elsewhere. In fact, the media is underrepresented. The biggest threat, which this video also touched upon, is to Sindhi's Hindus, is the forced conversion of their girls to Islam. As a being a woman and a mother of two little girls, this is too close to my heart. And current statistics estimates that every month, more than 20 Hindu girls are abducted and converted into Islam. Numbers may be higher, but official figures are difficult to obtain because the police often refuse to register cases of forced conversion and work in conjunction with the religious institution who cover or legitimize their conversions. And usually a number of politicians, member of assemblies, national assemblies are involved in these conversion. This is more a systematic rather than an ad hoc basis. It's not, I would say, you know, sometimes discriminations are generated by the society or the social setup, but this is more a political initiation. I think that the reason behind this is that this is one of the weakest element of in a family to save their daughter in our Asian culture. So they can actually, this would be so sensitive that they will push them that they can leave the region and the country. And actually, it's more sort of a national perspective because they want to weaken the Sindhi nation as well. And if Sindhi nation is a combination of Hindu Sindhis and Muslim Sindhis and many other religions, as we have Christians as well. But this is more sort of a politicizing and a more a systematic element. And also the drive of, because we have the majority of Hindus in our region, the whole drive of the making Pakistan as a Puritan state, and obviously the Sufism and Hinduism being as a Sindh as a hub, is one of the target for the government to really have a systematic approach. And I think the forced conversion is one of the key political sort of element has been introduced in Sindh province. Just to give you a little bit sad aspect of this is when that the girls are generally, most 99% are under 18, as young as 10. Once the girls have been married off, converted, they are prohibited from contacting their families, leaving them even more vulnerable for exploitation. To date, not a single perpetrator has been convicted because the state institutions, the judiciary, the whole legal system is work with perpetrators, work with the abductors. And that's the where I will be talking about it. No matter how much law we have, no matter how much legislation is, if the country is not intending to have a rule of law, sometimes these legislations and laws are really, it doesn't work. However, of course, laws do provide a skeleton, do provide some sort of protection. But what I was trying to say, the implementation of law and rule of law is more important rather than having just a legislation. Again, the issue is the constitutionally and the legal, that there's no going back for these young girls or the people who convert into Islam, because there's a death penalty, that sentence, if you convert coming converted Islam and you want to come back to the Hinduism or Christianism is a death sentence. So this is another legal instrument Pakistan actively uses. And that's why many girls who might be want to come back cannot, because obviously it becomes a quite a threat to the families and to themselves. In many cases, women are also told that their families are kafirs, so they cannot really meet, because once they become Muslim, they are really not allowed to meet to the kafirs. This impends their access to the justice. And you probably recently heard the case of Rubina and Rubina, where the two sisters were converted, and you will question about it. Why would they marry to a married woman who has got a lot of children and wives already? So that's I bring to the focus on the Hindu, the scheduled caste. We also have in Sindh, and maybe that term has been used in South Asian context. Generally, these people are economically deprived. This community faces extra discrimination, the scheduled caste, and I wouldn't call the scheduled caste, because I call them indigenous tribes of Sindh. I'm very proud of these castes, but these are the most vulnerable community who practice Hinduism but suffers the most victimization, because their abduction of their children, abduction or the violence against them is not even reported, because they are so marginalized, they are so unknown to the mainstream population of Pakistan or mainstream media that their challenge is not even covered. And I think this is where I would like to bring attention. At the moment, 1.7 million people are enslaved as a bonded laborers in Pakistan, and they all are Hindus generally. As a result of outstanding financial debt, they may be debt to the landlords or feudals and so on. There's a lot of reports been done by international community, like anti-slavery and all this. They will report, they have exact data and figures. We also, Pakistan has got actually law as well, which is called 92 Bonded Labor System Abolition Act. And recommendation made in the previous review, the local government officials have failed to enforce the Bonded Labor Abolition Act. And the police often fail to register these complaints against these abusive landowners. The bonded labor system is characterized by patterns of abuse, detention, and exploitation, and one of the most vulnerable. Sometimes these people are not even registered, they are not part of the censuses, so absolutely there's no clue where these people are. And there's been saying that the Beals, I can translate it, the Beals, the girl of age of 12 doesn't grow up because she ends up in the brothels. That's where the situation of these people are. On the political front, though they are proportionally, we have allocated seats for the minorities in the Pakistan National Assembly, in the Senate, in the provisional assemblies, but they are again very, remain at the mercy of the major political parties. So these parties, again, they select their candidates who is actually able to not challenge their status quo, really. Simply they will select the candidates who are yes men. They wouldn't select any candidate from minorities who would say or opposed to their status. This religious extremism, discrimination, and violence against minorities are mainly due to significant policies attributed to the state of Pakistan, and we must have heard, we all internationally know about the discriminatory law and blasphemy law. Recently, we had a case of Asia Bibi who traveled to Canada. These are the laws which surpass the religious vigor and have been used against journalists, religious minorities, and have promoted and increased religious extremism and intolerance. The government is not taking steps to quell the rise of intolerance, but has moved to increase it by standing by blasphemy law, not taking action against groups or who promotes the violence. The reality is, it's more systematic, really. Twice the Sindh of government attempted to outlaw forced conversion and marriages, including laying guidelines for the court processes in protection of minority bills, placing an age limit of 18 years upon conversion, and enabling better due process. In 2016, the bill was unanimously passed by the Assembly, but religious parties objected to an age limit of conversion and threatened to besiege the Assembly if the bill received approval from the governor. Again, in 2019, a revised version was introduced, but again, religious parties protested again, and obviously, the bill was withdrawn from the Assembly. Since last year, Pakistan's support for religious freedom has only cosmetically really improved, because there was a lot of pressure from international community and UN, because we've been doing a lot of work at UN level. But incidents against Hindus have not decreased at all. I mean, even for last week, we had 7 girls abducted, which is reported. Obviously, I'm not talking about unreported cases and abductions of the Hindus, businessmen, really. The rise in religious extremism and violence against religious minority has been a mounting concern, making international headlines. But as I said, we have 3 levels of systematic prosecutions, which I would like to sum up in a sense that one is a constitutional. Under the constitutionally, legally, Hindus are second-class citizens in Pakistan, forbidden from many major government posts. Obviously, we have a blasphemy law. Then second, we have a government and military policies. Government pays lip service and reality by commission and omission, involved in prosecution of Sindhi Hindus. Government narrative is usually military initiated, is anti-Hindu, anti-India. All Sindhis in general are branded sort of Indian agents. And if you're bound to be a Hindu, then absolutely you would be. Textbooks are written with anti-Hindu slogan. In fact, if you look at the class 8, we call it grade 8 and 9 curriculum syllabus, it's actually conversion of a Hindu girl into a Muslim marriage is treated as a equal to a jihad, which is a very holy kind of preaching and war equality. So you could see that how they are brainwashing young boys in through the syllabus and through the education system as well. Local police and judiciary often ignores the crimes against Hindus. Then I would work on the third level, is which we call it establishment-led societal setup. This is where I would like to bring the attention that when Pakistan was formed, Pakistan had a 2,400 madrasas. Today we have a 24,000 madrasas. Mainly, a lot of madrasas are established in the areas where we have a Hindu populations or minority population. In particularly in Sindh, you would see that our madrasas, which are fully funded, directly funded from the capital, Islamabad, they are working in the district of Thar, which is border to the India, where our minority and Hindu community lives. And so you could see there is a systematic establishment-led societal setup is being introduced in Sindh, which is supposed to be the sort of secular state. And obviously, introduction of Wahhabism and the version of Islam, which is more fundamental than Sufi Islam. And obviously, the forced conversion and forced marriages. This is, again, it's very much related with how the mindset in the last 30 to 40 years has changed through the education system and the whole environment of the society. Despite stopping aid from the US, the US still carries a great deal of influence over Pakistan. The US must make its best and sincere efforts to create a real change in laws and practices which protect Sindhi Hindus and other minorities. It can start by asking Pakistan to create laws which immediately end forced conversion, but also not only the laws, but also implementation of laws. And any aid, any support which goes to the Pakistan should have some sort of condition. I'm just gonna give you an example that we had a funds coming from international community for COVID-19 in June. And it happened exactly what happened when we had a floods in 2010 and 2012. The all funds were distributed to the Muslim community. And unfortunately, there were indigenous tribes and Hindu communities, which we call them a hard to reach communities, were not able to get those funds because the funds were distributed through the Islamic organizations, not proper secular NGOs or something. So similar thing happened in COVID-19 in June when the funds arrived from international community were again handed over to the religious organization to distribute in the community. And actually what we in UK, we had to really generate specific funds from the Sindhi community here to send over our Hindu Sindhi brothers and sisters back home. And this is the reality. One other thing I would like to, which Dr. Ashok mentioned about, one hand, I am myself an immigrant and I support that when we immigrate, the host country should give us reasonable living standards and so on. But I would also think that it's very important to put a pressure on Pakistan that our Sindhi brothers and sisters should have a right to return. This is their motherland. This is where they were born. This is where bread and butter is there. And the country should, rather than giving up to the country that, okay, well, let the people go, why can't the international community make impact or make influence? We can make a lot of change. Pakistan has got a US and UK and European has got a lot of influence in Pakistan. They can make a change. I think this is where I would be looking at the US side of it, that the country should be at least at minimum comfortable for their own indigenous people who are actually, their ancestors are born from it. So one hand, I'm very positive that people should have be given the citizenship when they migrated for some reason. But in this case, especially, this is a systematic, a deliberate act on migration. And I think this is where international community can work with us to making sure people should have a right to return to their homeland. And I thank on that. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Greenwood. And I think you raised some really important points there and describing the discrimination and persecution that's happening to Hindus, mainly in Sindh, Pakistan. And your point that, you know, as Americans here, we actually are in the seat of power still in this world. And it's incumbent upon us, and what HAF has been trying to prioritize is trying to educate first our lawmakers on these issues that are happening in Pakistan, Bangladesh, and other countries, and then also trying to pressure them to make sure that our US taxpayer dollars are not supporting these types of violations. So I think that's a, you know, important point that while it's commendable what India is doing, the onus shouldn't be at the end of the day on India, but rather should be on the home countries to actually protect their populations and make sure that they are safe to live there if they choose. And if they don't want to live there, then they can leave, but they should not be forced or coerced under these types of circumstances to have to leave their native lands. So I want to thank you both again for that. And I want to now pass it on to the question and answer session. I see a lot of questions coming in, which is great. We're generating a lot of good discussion here. I want to introduce my colleague, HAF's Director of Public Policy, Tanyel Koshakjian, who is going to be going ahead and going through the questions. And we're going to try again to get to as many as possible. If we can't get to your question, you know, I apologize in advance, but please do reach out to us afterwards and we'd be happy to send you more information about anything that you're interested in, specifically about data. I know people have asked about data, both Dr. Greenwood and Mr. Karmaker and HAF, we have all collected data on all of these countries, and so we can provide that. And we're all doing, I think, really important work. So feel free to reach out to us afterwards if we're not able to answer your question. And we'd be happy to get you any information necessary and kind of help to all move together to advocate on these issues. But without further ado, I want to pass it on to Tanyel to go ahead and guide us through our question and answer session.
Thank you, Samir. And I want to thank everyone for their participation this evening. It's been a great discussion. I'm going to do something a little bit different here. So I'm going to read off three questions on Bangladesh specifically for Mr. Karmaker, and he can take them, and maybe he wants to write them down as I say them, because they're kind of short, but they really hit at the crux of what he was talking about. One of the questions from Rafij Hole asks, is the persecution of Hindus in Bangladesh simply ignored by the government, or does the government actively take part in the persecution in some way? There was also a question on number two. India assisted Bangladesh crucially in the past and helped it become a country. How come Bangladesh is not treating Hindus well, or India cannot make that happen, possibly through diplomacy? Thank you from Deval Shah. Another question, which I thought was really interesting, on the slide that you showed on the countries of origin of Hindu refugees, is it possible to explain why many of them go to Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates? That was from San Maharaj. And on the data, there was a question on do you have data on the number of victims there in Bangladesh? And I believe you do. And finally, what were the kind of incidents that took place in the last 3 months in Bangladesh? Mr. Maharaj was asking as well.
So Ashokda, I think if you want to go ahead, I think you're muted. If you want to unmute yourself, please.
And if you want me to repeat something, please let me know.
No, I heard you, but you know, you could not hear me. That's why. Okay, thank you very much. These questions are very important, I think, and they're very relevant too. First of all, first question was whether the government of Bangladesh ignores this all the incidents of atrocities, or they take part in it. Actually, a kind of both. They first ignore, and by ignoring those facts, and they are always in denial. They'll try to say that it did not happen because of religious belief or faith. It because of social discord, sometimes land dispute. All the time, they will find something land dispute. And why it is land dispute always with the Hindus? That is a question. So that way they ignore it. And by ignoring it, actually they are taking part in it. Because that is their duty as a government to protect all people, not only majorities or not only minorities, but everyone. So they fail it deliberately. And so always they'll be saying something, they'll be coming forward with some kind of excuses saying, you know, we cannot do many, many things here. We cannot just make them unhappy, like the jailers, Islamic jailers, or so-called things. But actually, if you look at, we showed this slides, thanks goes to our research team and led by Mr. Arghav Bhattacharya. So you can see this happened all the time. That means irrespective of any party in power, in Bangladesh, after the liberation, the Awami League, then BNP, Bangladesh Nationalist Party, and the Jatiyo Party, they have been in power all the time. And sometimes these military were in power too. But all the time, the population of Bangladeshi Hindus, they were leaving Bangladesh every single day. So actually, it doesn't make any difference who is in power. It is very much unimportant.
That's a very good distinction, I think. Can you talk a little bit about the types of incidences that happened in the last 3 months, and then maybe some of the migration patterns as far as going to Saudi Arabia and UAE? Yeah.
Okay, first of all, Saudi Arabia and UAE, I don't think that is significant. If you know the population, according to Bangladeshi diaspora, I have this information that about 10 million people from Bangladesh, they are living abroad. That is, they are migrants in different countries. And obviously in the Middle East, about 50% people, migrants are Bangladeshi origin, they're living in the Middle East.
And that's for work reasons, right? For
work reason. And yeah, there could be, there are some Hindus too, but you know, they're very minimal. And it is not, and you know, that by the nature, Hindus, what I have heard, most of the time, they are not even being taken there in those countries. And even if it is true, if you say 8% or 9% of them are there, that very much insignificant number compared to the people that if we look at our slides, and then you can find at least 29 million people. Because if we take into consideration that it's true, the government's, the Bangladesh Census Bureau's statistics, there's 22% people were there in 1951. So today, and the population-wise, it is only 8.5%, maybe 8%. So there will be a gap of about 29 million people. If it is 22% today, it will be 29 million people at least. So these huge people, population, where did go? Only in Middle East, in the Saudi Arabia, or in other countries, UAE, there are only 4.6 million people, and most of them are Muslims. So Hindus did not go to the Middle East in a significant number to show that they migrated, they left the country for the better life. So,
sure. And can you really quick talk about the incidents of the last 3 months before we turn it over to my next set of questions?
Yeah, so last 3 months, what have been happening last 3 months is not different from other months, other years. That's, we just try to show that in last 3 months, there are so many, like a few hundred in 1 month, 300 something. So
what kind of incidents?
Kind of there's the killing, obviously there, forcefully, evicting people from their home streets,
okay.
Then rape and forced conversion. Everything like, and also there are a few other things like rumors. They are using rumor, Facebook. Their Facebook, and they usually what happens with a fake account in name of others, Hindu names. They always use a Hindu name or a Buddhist name, most of the time Hindu names. And then from there, they will be putting some anti-Islamic things. And then hundreds of thousands of people will be gathering, and then they'll start looting, arsoning people, Hindu people, Hindu houses. And sure. They will be obviously killing people. That happened a few times during the pandemic too.
Thank you. All right, I'm gonna ask a couple of questions now for Dr. Greenwood. And then when you're done, I'm gonna ask some general questions that are for both of you and for Samir, I think would be great to weigh in. And that will wrap up our panel discussion for this evening. And that'll actually work as a good segue for our discussion tomorrow night. But I'm going to read off a couple of questions here for Dr. Greenwood on Pakistan in particular. Can you tell us a little bit about the 2017 Hindu Marriage Act? What is it? Why is it important? Is it serving its purpose? And I think that was a staff question from Suhag. One of the... what challenges or successes have you encountered in trying to galvanize major donors to take up an issue with Hindu refugee migration, perhaps UNHCR, and ways to make this a core policy in the future? That was from Vindhya. And really good question that came up that we'd like you to address. But I think it's really interesting. Can you explain why, the importance of citizenship to some of these Hindus? It was referenced, Siddharth Ka mentioned that he saw that the people in the video mentioned citizenship. And why did that stick out to him and to those people? Also, what are your thoughts on imposing sanctions on Pakistan to propel it? To applying legislation to protect against minority abuse. That was from Mr. Maharaj. There was also another question, if you could talk about the extremist cleric and Pakistani politician named Mian Abdul Haq, AKA Mian Mittu. Has this person been supported by the government of Pakistan? Can he be taken to the international court? And that was from Rupal Patel. So I'll turn it over to you, Dr. Greenwood.
Okay. The first part of the questions I might ask you to repeat it, but I'll just start with the Mian Mittu issue. Yes, I would say absolutely. He's running industry, I would say, of the allegedly forced conversion. Of course, I have to be careful to say, but he thinks there's no forced conversion, but hundreds and hundreds of people every week converse in his institution. And obviously, mostly underage, and why the mostly girls, not the boys. And so, you know, there are certain issues. Nobody dare to go into his institution and do the interviews. We have been trying to work with a lot of journalists and people to get access to the people who live in these institutions to get interviews or something. We've never been allowed to even get into that area. So all those area questions raise concerns that he's highly protected by the military. More than the civilian government, it's more protected by military, really, and Pakistani establishment. Absolutely, he needs to be. But the problem is, if we want to take him to the National Court of Justice, we need to have some way to get off those cases, evidences. At the moment, all these are allegedly. We need some evidence. We need an international support to have a strong journalism here, actually, to get into these dark and dingy space places of remote parts of Sindh, where we can get a cup, even a 5 cases evidence, we can build it. We can build it. But there are nobody's putting money in it. And I'm frankly opening in the international forum. Nobody's prepared to go into these areas as a journalist. Nobody's putting investment into that sort of area of
investigation. And I think that answers a couple of the questions about, you know, getting money and resources into those areas. I think that's a great point. One of the first questions, I'll just repeat it for you, was
about the marriage act. Is about the marriage act, I think.
Yes, the marriage act.
Frankly, I don't know the detail, but I do know that the Hindu lady didn't have the right to the divorce. And I think it was very, very much related with the right to divorce. But I won't comment because I don't know detail about it at the moment.
And maybe the importance of the citizenship, you know, what do you think that gentleman was, why he was talking about citizenship on that video?
I think he was talking about citizenship within the India when he's migrated, really. I think that's what he was saying. He wasn't talking about being in Pakistan or Sindh. So he was immigrant. He went to India and he was talking about citizenship to get in India. Is that right, Samir?
Yeah, that's correct. And so I think I can clarify on that is that a lot of times a lot of these refugees came on a tourist visa, a short term tourist visa that was to a specific city within India, and then they would just overstay their visa and not go back. So it's very difficult to get like interim legal status. Like here, you can get different types of visas in the US, and you can get green cards. There are certain steps, but in India, it's not so easy. So citizenship is the best path to be able to get all of the provisions that are provided economically, like economic accommodations from the government, also getting into educational institutions, being able to show your citizenship papers, and then even people that are looking to rent properties, being able to show legal citizenship papers. Now, there are some long-term visas that are given, but that is still, again, it's a makeshift solution. So citizenship at the end of the day is the best solution for these people to be able to avail themselves of every right and opportunity that other Indians have in the country.
Mm-hmm. And one question that just came in, I think actually is a great extension of that is, you know, the CAA applies to refugees who entered India before December 31st, 2014. Well, what about those who entered after? And that was from Nalini Chu.
Sure. So there is no specific law that deals with that. However, people can still apply for refugee status, asylum, and the Indian government can still make accommodations as they've done with the remaining Afghan Hindus and Sikhs. So many of you may be familiar with what just recently happened in Afghanistan, where a Sikh temple Gurdwara was attacked, and I believe about 25 people were killed. And so that was kind of the last straw for the 200 families or so of Hindus and Sikhs remaining in Afghanistan. India then, even though those people are currently seeking refuge in India today, India has offered them to provide them in the interim, long-term legal status in India, and then I think eventually will hopefully provide them with citizenship. So there is no comprehensive policy dealing with post-2015 refugees that have come from these countries, but we're hoping that, you know, beyond some of these makeshift measures that's being done for like the Afghan refugees, that there will be more comprehensive policies that are implemented in the future.
Thank you, Samir. And I'm going to last, we may go like 2 minutes over here, but I want to ask these general questions and then open it up to you. I'll turn it back over to you, Samir, to close with the panelists. And this really hits at what you just said. You know, one of the questions came in, have Hindus in Pakistan and Bangladesh asked U.S. congressmen or women or Hindu Americans asked on their behalf, U.S. Members of Congress to grant refugee status? There was a question from Siddharth Ka on Jackie Spears resolution HRES 1085 that talks about P1 status, which is part of the Lautenberg. I'll let you elaborate on that and not P2 and what the distinction is there. And generally, Amit Joshi asked, what is the best way we here in the U.S. can help educate and shift congressional opinion on the issues regarding Hindu refugee issues throughout South Asia?
So in terms of the question of whether refugees from Pakistan or minorities from Pakistan and Bangladesh have been appealing to get, or whether the community has been appealing for them to get refugee status or asylum here in the U.S., and I think Ashokta has probably dealt with some cases, but from my knowledge, the best of my knowledge, they are sporadic and there's been no large-scale effort as such to be able to get them refugee status or asylum here. And that's for two reasons. One is India is the closest destination, so it's the most practical. I mean, you're just crossing really a border for the most part. And so it's just a much more practical solution. And number two is because it is very difficult for refugees from these particular countries to meet the standard of proof and evidence required to get asylum or refugee status here. And there's no history. I know Ashokta had pointed out a number of different legislative initiatives here in the US that were dealing with specific countries and refugees from those countries. But there's been nothing that's been done with Pakistan or Bangladesh to large part because they've been allies of the US. And so they're not going to admit that there's a huge problem, or if there is a huge problem, they're not going to open the floodgates. So that is kind of the difficulty here at this end, and then the practicality of them being able to just go to India. Now, that being said, for the Afghan Hindus and Sikhs, this is an issue that we've also advocated for because it's a small group. I mean, when you're talking about 200 families versus, you know, millions of people between Bangladesh and Pakistan, it's a much different scenario. So what we did at HAF, and I know other groups have done also, is advocated for them to be able to come either to the U.S. We also advocated for them to be given refugee legal status in India if they so chose to go there, or if they wanted to come to the U.S. We've been working on a Senate initiative to get them to come to the U.S., to be able to be allowed refugee status here in the U.S. And there are different procedures and you know, different ways to get in. And as what Tanya was referring to is there's a different clause under the refugee laws here. It's called the P2. And it's just an easier way for them to be able to get. I don't want to get into too many of the intricacies. I can, you know, if somebody has a follow-up question afterwards, I can send that. But it's basically, it makes it easier to get into under the clause that we were advocating for. And this is something that a Senate led letter had supported as well to the State Department. And it's something that we are pushing for, but now I think it seems like they're going to be going into India. These refugees are going to be going to India, which again is the most practical and easiest solution for the time being. Great. I think we are now at the end of our time. A lot of good questions coming in. Unfortunately, again, we're not able to get to all of them. But I want to first thank again Mr. Karmaker and Dr. Greenwood for very important and passionate talks about their respective you know, homelands and what's going on there to religious minorities and what all we need to do and the international community needs to do to help provide some sense of relief to those victims, whether it's to improve their conditions and leverage and put pressure on the international community to allow them to stay in their home countries, or if they are fleeing their home countries to provide safety and security and a legal path to citizenship and some refugee status in the countries of their adopted homelands. And so again, I want to thank them for all the work that they're doing. They both produce a lot of great data through their respective organizations on these issues and document them. It's something that we're also doing at the Hindu American Foundation, and we will be releasing our human rights report, our annual human rights report, later this year in December to coincide with International Human Rights Day. So please keep a lookout for that. And you know, the simplest thing that everybody here can do is to sign up for our Dharma Advocates training program to learn how to talk about these issues to our policymakers. It's gonna, you know, require a systematic effort. It's gonna require a consistent effort, but these trainings that we're gonna be providing are a way to be able to reach your members of Congress, your local and state officials, to educate them on these issues and how to specifically ask for certain outcomes. And so please do join us on October 1st for that. Go to our homepage again, hindoamerican.org. Go to the upcoming events section and sign up there. And space is limited, so please do that as soon as possible. Now, if you are also able to join us tomorrow, that would be wonderful. We're going to be shifting again the conversation to domestic issues and advocacy at the local and state level. And we have a great panel planned for you tomorrow as well. And you can sign up on the same hindoamerican.org homepage. You'll see a big banner about the advocacy forum. Just click on the register button and go to day two and register for the Zoom link there, and you'll get a invitation and a password to join tomorrow. Finally, please do continue to engage with us on social media at the hashtag HAFADFO2020. Continue to raise awareness about these issues. This program is being recorded. It's also being live streamed right now, thanks to Diya TV, and it will be available on their YouTube channel. So if it's something that you want to send to people, share on social media, we'll also be sending out the link, but go ahead and look it up right now on YouTube under the Diya TV channel. And finally, if you believe that HAF's work and all of this is necessary and important work, please do support us at hindoamerican.org/donate and continue to support this work and make programs like this possible. And with that, I want to thank all of our speakers again very much for their time and their efforts and for their ongoing activism. We've had the pleasure of knowing both of them for many years, and I know they've been doing great work both on the ground in their countries of origin in Pakistan and Bangladesh, and also in the diaspora, whether here in the US or in the United Kingdom. So once again, thank you to Dr. Greenwood, Mr. Karmaker. Thank you for being with us, and please do continue to follow their work as well. Dr. Greenwood is with the World Sindhi Congress, and Mr. Karmaker is with the Bangladesh Hindu Buddhist Christian Unity Council. And with that, everyone, I want to wish you all a good night. Namaste and
good night. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.